What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here from Nation Fusion, and today I have a review for you for Mass Effect Andromeda. This one took a little longer than I expected. There was just a lot going on, a lot of controversy, a lot of issues, and then a lot of just personal kind of decompression that I needed to do so that I could judge this game fairly and deliver an accurate and honest review to you and not let my Mass Effect love for the franchise and things like that kind of taint or ruin the actual review of this game. So Mass Effect Andromeda is the next installment in the Mass Effect series from BioWare, and I gotta say, it disappointed me quite a bit. It's not a terrible game at its core, and I can recommend anybody looking for a new game to play or anybody who might be interested in playing the game, I can recommend that you buy it. It is worth the money. There's a lot of content there. There's some good story arcs there. There are some good underlying things here. The visual style, the combat, things like that. They all feel really good, but the game has a few key issues, and we're going to dive into them in a kind of different format than we usually do. I know a lot of times when I do these reviews, they are done in a kind of like a mishmash style. I just cover one thing to the next, and I kind of segue myself into other topics. Here, I'm going to talk about each of the gameplay scoring elements here, each of the elements that we score these games on. We're going to talk about those in an individual format. That way things can stay a little more organized because this review could get pretty lengthy. Just want to warn you right now. So let's talk about gameplay. Gameplay is going to encompass all of the things about playing the actual game, the core mechanics, not the story and things like that. We're just going to talk about the core gameplay mechanics, and there's some good and there's some bad. So let's start off with kind of like combat. So combat in this game is very fluid. It's very fast paced. There's a lot going on to it. However, with the amount of kind of speed that you get and the new kind of fluidity from like jetpacks and things of that nature, you do get some problems here, and that is with some of the squad AI. So the squad AI that you have now, you can control with the left or right buttons on your D-pad or on your computer, a different key combination, maybe Q and E, I think. But really, where it comes down to is they've actually removed like squad abilities and squad powers from your particular control. So no longer can you request a teammate to deploy a certain biotic capability or apply a certain concussive shot or something like that to a specific target. The AI kind of operate on their own and use their skills and abilities when they decide to, and not necessarily when you need them to. This, you know, kind of dumbs down the combat. And again, we're looking at a next generation game, and the next generation of Mass Effect, and we're still going in with two AI. I mean, I feel like the way this game was set up, we, you know, bringing in a fourth member and then adding some more enemies could have really drove home the amount of kind of tension that this game really was lacking. But on the strictly on the gameplay side, there are some other elements that are pretty neat. You have the Nomad introduced here, which is kind of like a revitalized Mako. It handles much better. However, there just wasn't a whole lot for it to do other than driving you from point A to point B. You can use it to mine some specific resources on specific areas of maps, and then those resources allow you to upgrade and customize your armor and gear, which is the next kind of gameplay element that we'll talk about, and that's the customization. There are some, there's quite a few different tiers. So when you get like a one assault rifle has several tiers of it, so there's not necessarily a ton of guns in the game or a ton of armor sets or a ton of equipment, but there are plenty of tiers to upgrade after that. And I found like the rate that you earn the research points to unlock the blueprints to then build here, there's just a bridge and a gap, and I believe at some point in time, maybe towards the end of the game, this should have become an automated feature where you can maybe recruit somebody who is gaining points for you and then using those points to research for you. That way you don't have to manually do it every single time, or maybe have that as an option for later on for people who don't want to do it. After you've got a certain amount of research points, choose what you want researched: weapons, armor, or equipment, and then let your research points be spent on those in no particular order, or maybe on like a timer or something like that. that would be okay and that would be pretty cool. But the way that this thing kind of works is while you're out in the field, you can scan technology and the technology will give you research points. And then you can also get research points from playing like multiplayer or sending your teams out on missions. And then you use those points to unlock blueprints. And then you use those blueprints to build items. So it's kind of like a multi-tiered system. And yes, it does add some kind of like buffing and padding for gameplay. So you have kind of more to do. It also gets pretty tedious after some time. So that was definitely a big concern of mine, but something I can kind of get past. Other than that, there was just a couple of casual outfits. I would have liked some more. Like I said, this is, you know, the next installment of Mass Effect. This is years after a trilogy, and, you know, I expected some more content as far as, like, gear goes and customization options and things like that. There are some customizations options coming in a future patch for the character creation screen, which I really didn't have a super big problem with. I was able to get the rider that I wanted to build. I do see, however, people who maybe wanted a little more variety there. There was very, very much a kind of disconnect between this is what you can build and then this is what you want to build. It's really tough to kind of get the character that you want. But for me, it was pretty easy because I usually just roll with a bald guy with a beard and a tattoo because I'm that guy. So that's how the gameplay looks. Like I said, the elements of the gameplay are there. There are some things that I didn't like. There was really my biggest pet peeve on this particular subject was the fact that driving the Mako into water or off a cliff, or if you jump off a cliff with your jetpacks and things like that, you just automatically respawn with like no shields. It's weird. There should be a punishment. You maybe should die and have to restart. That would cause you to, you know, be a little more careful and look where you're going and that kind of thing. And then when you're playing something like, you know, single player or multiplayer, you can jump off these edges to avoid combat. And yes, you're going to lose your shield, and yes, you may lose a little bit of health eventually, but you know, really you could just jump off you know, the cliff 10 times or so and be at half health and be avoiding like fire or whatever. It just breaks a little bit of the immersion there. Next thing I wanted to talk about was the graphics. So the graphics look good. The game handles a lot of nice textures and new color schemes, and there's just a lot going on here. Some of the worlds were pretty beautiful. You've got things like a nice, luscious kind of tropical world where it's raining. You've got a couple of deserts. I believe there's two desert planets. And the graphics are very nicely done on those particular elements. The character models, for the most part, the aliens and things that look really well. But on the graphics, we're going to talk about animations here as well. So animations are a big issue here with Mass Effect Andromeda. I'm sure if you're watching this review, you probably have seen some issues or maybe some news articles and things like that with animations and stuff. I ran into a few of them, nothing crazy or like game breaking where I needed to reload or anything like that. But I did run into some goofy looking animations, and I can totally understand where people are upset about that. I personally didn't get any gigantic animation issues. I'm going to get to my bigger issues later. But as far as animations go and graphics go, that kind of stuff, they're all okay. They're not great. There are some standout planets that look better than others. There are some issues with some of the animations and things like that. And really, for me, it's not really about the graphics or animation. I can get past some of that stuff. It's really about the story and, you know, the interplay of the story with the crew and things like that, which we'll get to in our story section. So graphically and animation wise, that kind of stuff, graphically good, animation wise decent, nothing to write home about. And I expected a little more from BioWare and you know, the guys working on Mass Effect to really kind of doctor this game up, give it some love. It really has to be a great game to follow up the trilogy. They set the bar themselves that way, and I feel like here they've definitely lowered the bar. There are some, you know, people who have compared Mass Effect 3 to Mass Effect Andromeda and seen that Mass Effect 3 in some cases has better animation and better facial expressions and things like that. And that's not really something that should be happening, especially this far into you know, video game history. I mean, you put out a huge trilogy, and then you put out, you know, a couple of years after that to work on this particular game, and this is what we are delivered, and it's just subpar. It's not the best. Moving on, I want to talk about sound. So sound design in this game is amazing. I did love all the sounds here. The music was pretty good. It wasn't as memorable as maybe something in the Mass Effect 3 trilogy, but it definitely was good. The sounds for the weapons were cool. The sounds for, like, reloading, you can hear thermal clips hitting the floor. That was good. The battle sounds were good. The Nomad sounds good. Everything sounds good in the game. I really did enjoy the soundtrack and the sounds for this game. Up next, we want to talk about single player. Okay, single player is a multitude of different things for us here. This encompasses things like story arcs and overall gameplay design for a single person to play, as well as different things for you to do in the single player. So, like, variety of objectives and variety of missions and things like that. This is where the game starts to fall apart for me. I did not enjoy the story of Mass Effect Andromeda anywhere near what I thought I was going to. I really had the idea of going to Andromeda and meeting all of these different types of aliens and discovering and being an alien. And really, this is kind of how it happens. You enter the galaxy, you get shot at by some bad guys who kind of are unexplained at this point. And then later on, you meet another alien race, and the alien race happens to be friendly, and you guys team up to beat the other alien race. There was no tension for me in this entire story, even fighting the Kett, which are the bad guy aliens. I didn't ever feel like I could lose. I didn't feel like anybody on my squad was ever in danger. I didn't feel like the Mass Effect Andromeda Initiative was ever in any real danger. There was no losing conditions for this game. This is clearly a game where you just play till you win. It doesn't matter the choices that you make or anything like that. Nothing bad can happen to you. Aside from minor spoiler here for anybody who hasn't played it, but you're going to see this within the first few minutes of the game. So if you're not worried about, you know, beginning spoilers, then feel free to stay here. But your father dies in the beginning, and your brother or sister, depending on the character that you play, is left in a coma. And that really is the end of the drama of the game. I didn't feel at any point, like I said, there was no danger to my crew. There was a couple of missions where you have to rescue people who seem to be in danger, like different pathfinders for the different races. But at no point did I ever feel like in Mass Effect 2 where, you know, if I made the wrong choice in the collector base where my crew could die, or I never felt like not doing the loyalty missions. Like in Mass Effect 2, there was, you know, these loyalty missions, and you were sometimes threatened if you didn't do them, or sometimes people would dislike you if you didn't do them, or until you did the mission for them, that kind of thing. Here, everybody loves you no matter what, and you know, they only love you more the more loyalty missions that you do for them. And that for me, that's really what destroyed the story for this game. Is I never ever felt in danger. I never felt like the Kett could beat me. I always felt like I was on top of everything here. And there's some crazy stuff going on in the background with this new technology from the Remnant, which is kind of a third alien species, but really just like some robots similar to kind of like the Geth or something like that. But they're more maintenance. They almost remind me of, like, if Geth were the keepers on the Citadel, and you got too close to their, like, workstations, they attack you or something like that. So I was really, really disappointed, even more so than the story, about the amount of new alien species that we got. There was a couple of different life forms to find on the planets that you visit. A lot of them are just the same animal kind of recolored, and maybe a minor retexture, but they're really like the same animal. And you know, the enemy variety is just not very good here. You're gonna fight Kett. The Kett have a couple of different types of enemies within them. They've the standard Kett soldier, then you've got kind of like a bigger, tougher, buffer guy that has like a machine gun. Then you have the stealth guy, and then you have like the main boss guy that you fight a couple of different times just under a different name. So those are the Ket bad guys, and then you fight the Remnant, who are different types of robots. There's just a couple of them. There's a giant one that's really kind of like just a reskin of the mechs, those giant mechs that you fight in Mass Effect 3. Other than that, they have another one that varies very, very similar to Arachni in Mass Effect 3 with its beams and shields and all that kind of stuff. It feels lazy is what I'm trying to get at. It feels lazy. The Angora, I didn't really like them very much. I mean, they were okay, but they didn't stand out as something like new to Andromeda. When I saw my first Angora, I really could have confused it with a Milky Way alien that maybe I hadn't seen, maybe like an Elcor mixed with a Volus or something like that. There's just a lot of issues there. And then the Ket are just reincarnated versions of Angora and other species. Some other of the different Milky Way species make their appearance here. You've got Asari, you've got Salarians, you've got Turians, those kind of things. Those are all present. There's a couple of things missing. There was a teaser hint for Quarians coming in and some other ones as well. So maybe we'll see that in some DLC. But really, the story and the arcs here, they're just pretty terrible. As far as romancing options, there's quite a few different ones here. They did go a little more risque with the sex scenes in the game, so you will see a little more than you've seen in any of the other Mass Effects, which is nice. It adds a little more an adult theme, but the amount of people that you can actually do this particular cutscene with are not very wide. But some of the different characters aboard the Tempest can alleviate some of that romance pressure if you're not really wanting to do that, or maybe you do have a romance going on but you want some more interactions from different people. You can do that. You can go about it in whatever way you want. It doesn't seem that Mass Effect really locks you into a romance like the other ones until like later on down the road. But with that said, let's talk a little bit about the characters. The characters in this game, they bore me to death. Jesus Christ, guys. I tell you this, I do like the game. I know it's tough to believe at this point, but I do really like the game. I think there's some good stuff in there. However, let's start at the front of the Tempest and work our way back. So at the front, you've got your pilot and you've got your medical officer. These two, the pilot's name is Callow, I believe, and I don't like him. He was very uninteresting to me. There was no point where I felt he was necessary. He could have been any character. He could have been, Lee Harvey Oswald, and I wouldn't have fucking noticed because the interactions with him were so boring. Aside from him, you have Suvi, who I at first found interesting and then quickly got tired of hearing her. She's one of those characters that is voice acted very well, but written very badly. So Suvi and Kylo at the front of the ship, not the biggest fans though. So then moving farther back, you have Liam and Cora. So Liam is probably the most boring character I've ever seen in a Mass Effect game. All of the dialogue and interactions with him are retarded, and I really disliked all of them. In fact, he sends you on some kind of fetch quest to get a movie and have movie night, which is cool in theory, but never leads anywhere. You never get to see a movie, and Liam just seems really boring, and his loyalty missions are for you to put outposts on planets. So Liam, again, great voice actor, like the guy behind the voice, but written poorly, just boring. Just a boring kind of guy. Cora, on the other hand, is a little better. I feel like they pushed this particular character, though, down a certain road rather than Cora being her own character. I felt like she was written this way. And that if I can spot that, that's a bad sign. But I did like Cora's backstory. Her missions were a little more entertaining than some of the other crew. And really, for me, I think Korra was one of my favorites. Not my favorite. We're going to get to that one next. But she was one of my favorites out of all the characters on the ship. Next up is PB. This character is by far the best. Whoever voiced PB did a great job. Maybe we'll work on getting her on the interview show at some point. But PB is the most interesting, has the most to tell, and has the most like diverse and unique personality of all the crew. She's one of those people that's a loner but is willing to work with you, and she pokes fun at you, but she kind of likes you at the same time. She doesn't get along really with the rest of the crew, but the rest of the crew like her because she's not, you know, intentionally rude and that kind of thing. She has a good dynamic about her, and I think she fits well with Andromeda. Next up, we have Vetra, another incredibly boring character. After seeing Nyrene on, you know, Mass Effect 3's Omega DLC, I had some high expectations for a Turian female, and this one I just thought was boring. She could have been a human, and I wouldn't have noticed. She has the you know, mercenary drifter kind of attitude. She also has like a sister that she cares about, so what kind of mercenary really is she, and what kind of drifter is she if she has a sister that she brings along with her everywhere? I didn't really like her. Again, voice acted well, but you know, just written to the point of who the fuck cares. I mean, really. Gil in engineering, this guy was okay. I like some of the I like the idea of some of the stuff that you get to do with Gil, like meeting his friends and going to play cards with him or whatever. But I would have liked some more interaction there. Maybe let me play the card game. Maybe have some things for me to do with my crew interactively on the ship. But Gil wasn't that bad, and I did like the idea and the kind of premise of what Gil was there to do. And then Drac, a Krogan, man. What a waste of a Krogan. This guy had the potential to be great. There's very shining moments in the game where you're like, oh yeah, Drac's a badass. And then there's times where he's talking about his granddaughter and all of this shit. And I'm like, this is not the Krogans that we're accustomed to. This is a much more docile Krogan. Even though he's a warrior and like an old breed, you would expect him, if he was a quote-unquote old breed, to be a lot more violent and a lot more kind of the antagonist protagonist, the guy who wants you to do the you know, the less moral and the more darker things. You just never really get that from Drac. They're just boring characters all around here, guys. I could go on all day about all of them. I'm not going to waste any more time. The single player in this game is decent. It's there. For me, I just didn't enjoy the story or the characters as much as I did. Some of them were good. Some of the missions that you'll encounter seem very like hipsterish. I don't know if this game was written by hipsters, but there's missions in the game like go collect ingredients for beer, or go deliver a message to my stripper girlfriend who's not really my girlfriend and I'm in jail so I can't deliver the message myself. A couple of different types of like fetch quests that don't make any sense that a Pathfinder would be doing. There's a lot of just like problems with the game. As far as replayability, this is where the game took another hit for me. I feel like there's no reason for me to go back and replay the game as the other sibling, only because I don't see anything that could possibly be different. I don't know if there is or not. I've put 80, 90 hours into the game already, and I don't feel like I need to replay it. In fact, the way that things handle, you know, the amount of missions here, I'm just going to be doing the same missions with a female and hear some different voice dialogue. That for me is not going to cut it. It's not going to work for me to do it that way. Plus, I think really when you talk replayability, especially on a game that limits the amount of planets that you can explore, there's only about 7 planets to go on. I'm like, why would I do any of this over again? As where when I played Mass Effect 3 or 2, or sometimes even 1 to a certain extent, you can go back and play as a male or female, and each like mission that you go do has different outcomes and different paths for you to take. Here, when you go on a planet, you're just going to go do the side missions. Some of those side missions have choices. Some of them have like little action-orientated things for you to do at the bottom, like pull the right trigger for you know, this kind of move, or don't pull the trigger at all to not do it, that kind of thing. They said there was going to be more of those in the game. I didn't notice very many. I mean, there's a few. There's, you know, maybe 10 to 12 that I remember personally doing throughout my playthrough, but a lot of them are fucking retarded, man. Like, one was like, give Korra a hug, punch a guy, shoot a guy. Like, come on, man, get creative. Like, let me do something in the game with some impact and some meaning. I just didn't feel any of that here. Unfortunately, guys, Mass Effect Andromeda was not the game that everybody thought it would be. I predicted the game was going to score in the 9 range on the overall on OpenCritic. I was incredibly wrong, and I am not even going to score the game anywhere near that. For me, Mass Effect Andromeda is an above average game, but it's not a great game. I'm going to be scoring this game a 7 out of 10. It's not great. It's a 5 for me is middle of the road, average type of game. This one is a little bit more. It earns itself 2 more points from the 5 up to a 7 because it does have some unique features. It does have some great combat. It does have an amazing soundtrack. It does have some good stuff for you to do, and it is content filled. You will be able to play this game for quite some time. You're definitely going to get your money's worth, and those particular points combined together give this game a 7 out of 10. It really could have been more if some more thought was put to the story, if there was some danger in the story, if I felt compelled to play. I think I've gone like 2 weeks without even loading up the game. I'm just kind of like, all right, and I've done maybe 60 or 70% of the game. There's still 20% more to do. I've completed the main story, but as far as like actual mission content and stuff, I still have plenty of stuff to do, plenty of planets to finish exploring and things like that. And I don't have the will to. I don't see the reason why. I've already beat the story. It was a weird cliffhanger type of ending. And, you know, the bad guy at the end looked like the bad guy at the beginning. It just wasn't doing it for me, guys. So 7 out of 10 for us here on Nation Fusion. And I really do hope the next, DLC pack or the next installment of the game really ups the ante and really makes you feel like you have something to lose and really puts that weight back on your shoulders of being the first people in a new galaxy. And really, I could go on forever with this video because we haven't even talked about the disconnect between this game and the original Mass Effect series. Maybe we can do that in another video. As far as reviewing this game, though, that's what we're scoring. It's 7 out of 10. It's got issues, but it is worth a pickup if you are looking for a new game to play. I can recommend it. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you did, let me know in the comments down below what you think of Mass Effect Andromeda and what you think of, you know, Mass Effect as a whole, as a series now. I would be definitely interested in hearing what you guys have to say down below. Until next time, though, I'll see you on Nation Fusion.